Hello and welcome to the Roundtable Podcast. My name is Shogun. Joining me today, once again, is my friend Hermes for part of our formal debate series on the Roundtable Discord server. We're going to have a five-round debate on the subject of religion. And the specific question is religion a good or a bad thing for society? And I'll be arguing that it's a good thing. Hermes will be arguing that it is a harmful thing. Before we get started, make sure you join the Roundtable Discord server. We record podcasts every day, usually at 9 p.m. Central, as well as other times. Check the announcements channel for upcoming special events, and check the RT podcast channel for our hundreds of great past interviews, podcasts, debates, and special events hosted on various YouTube and BitChute and SoundCloud channels. All of them can be found there. Please like, follow, and subscribe. Just a quick reminder, there's five rounds, 5 minutes each. The moderator is Destrix. He'll keep track of the time. He'll notify the speakers when they have 1 minute remaining and when they're out of time, and the speaker is asked to drop the mic immediately when they run out of time, even if they're mid-sentence. After the debate, there will be a series of three straw polls posted, and the people who listen to the debate will be asked to vote on three questions. One, which person's position did you agree with? Which position did you agree with? The second is, who do you think did better debating, whether you agreed with them or not, who performed better in terms of the skill of the debate? And third, did listening to the debate change your mind? And there is no winners or losers. It's just for our interest and education. So, long-winded introduction out of the way. Welcome, Hermes. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing good. Thank you for asking. Thank you for creating this opportunity. So I'll go whenever, you know, the moderator says go.
Great. So Destrix, when you say start, Hermes will begin his first round.
Alrighty, guys. Keep it lean, keep it clean. And Hermes, you have 5 minutes, and I'll give you a 1 minute warning, and your time starts now.
All right, so I think before anything else, we need to define what a religion is. And I'm getting a lot of these things from a book called Sociology in Our Time, or In Our Times. And I'm just going to be reading the short definition of religion real quick so we have a common ground. Religion is a social institution composed of a unified system of beliefs, symbols, and rituals based on some sacred or supernatural realms that guide human behavior, gives meaning to life, and unites believers into a community. Religion is sometimes thought of as a platform for the expression of spirituality, the relationship between the individual and something larger than oneself, such as a broader sense of connection with the surrounding world. Both religion and spirituality require that persons engage in a leap of faith, a confident belief that cannot be proven or disproven, but is accepted as true. This is just what religion is. And before anything else, I need to point out that I'm not disputing that there can be positives that come out of religion. For example, if you tell someone that they're going to go to hell if they don't, you know, continue doing heroin or some shit, and then they stop, and then they get better, yeah, their life got better. But the question is, could there have been better ways of persuading that person? And my argument is yes. So, like, it's not so much that religion is not functional. It is functional, and I'm going to actually point out some of the functions. It's just that there are better alternatives out there, such as philosophy, and more importantly, rationality. So I'm going to give the pros from the functionalist perspective. And again, I'm taking most of this from the book. So there are a couple benefits of religion. One is meaning and purpose. Religion offers meaning for the human experience. Some events create a profound sense of loss on both an individual basis, such as injustice, suffering, or the death of a loved one, and a group basis, such as famine, earthquake, economic depression, or subjugation by an enemy. Inequality may cause people to wonder why their own situation is no better than it is. Most religions offer explanations for these concerns. Explanations may differ from one religion to another, yet each tells the individual or group that life is part of a larger system of order in the universe. Some, but not all, religions offer hope of an afterlife for persons who follow the religious tenets of morality in this life. Such beliefs help make injustices easier to endure. So that's one of the key benefits of it. Another one is social cohesion and a sense of belonging. So by emphasizing shared symbols, religious teachings and practices help promote social cohesion. An example is the Christian ritual of communion, which not only commemorates a historical event, but also allows followers to participate in the unity, communion of themselves with other believers. All religions have some form of shared experience that rekindles the group's consciousness of its unity. And another one is social control and support for the government. All societies attempt to maintain social control through systems of reward and punishments. Sacred symbols and beliefs establish powerful, persuasive, long-lasting motivations based on the concept of a general order of existence. In other words, if individuals consider themselves to be part of a larger order that holds the ultimate meaning in life, it will feel bound to one another in a way that might not be possible otherwise. Religion also helps maintain social control in a society by conferring supernatural legitimacy on the norms and laws of society. In some societies, social control occurs as a result of direct collusion between the dominant classes and the dominant religious organizations. Here's another one. Religion provides social meaning for individuals as they learn about beliefs, rituals, and religious ideas from others. This learning process contributes to personal identity, which in turn helps people adjust to their surroundings. For example, children may learn appropriate conduct during the Christian sacraments of communion or the Lord's Supper by attending instruction classes for prospective church members, or by observing how their parents and other adults quietly and reverently participate in the ceremony. And then there is other benefits as well with respect to making people want to work harder, and also it motivates people to do the right thing, maybe not by reason, but still it promotes people to do the right thing in many, many times. That's basically about all the pros, and I'm going to get more into the cons, and I'm going to focus on it next time. I just want to acknowledge that I am fully aware of the benefits, and also there is a study that I posted in Podcast Test that goes over many, 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 many other studies in different countries analyzing if religion is good for health. And in general, it is.
Okay, thank you. And now, Shogun, your round one will commence in just a moment. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'll give you a warning at 1 minute left, and your 5 minutes will start now.
Okay. So thank you, Hermes, for reviewing and acknowledging many of the benefits of religion. I'm going to confirm that and just go over some of these articles very briefly. I posted in general chat. Just, you don't need to read them, but you could just read the titles, and this just confirms scientifically what Hermes was saying. And again, the point of this debate is religion a positive or a negative force in society? And I'm going to argue that there are many demographics and statistics that can give us a portrait of different aspects of social well-being. In other words, what is positive or beneficial for society? And this is sort of what you would consider in any policy. So anytime you're considering like what you should do as a society, what you should invest in or what direction you should go, these are the kind of indicators you would look at to measure if something was successful or not. And again, benevolence means like good intention or being well-intentioned towards other things or being compassionate towards other people. And I think that has to be the basis of all morality and obviously also the basis of policy, because if you're not making your policy to help people, then you're not being benevolent. It can't be positive for society, essentially, except accidentally, perhaps. So suicide rates, right? We want suicide rates to be low, and we find that in more religious countries, suicide rates are dramatically lower than in countries where most people are not religious. So as a policy to reduce suicide rates, encouraging healthy forms of religion is an effective strategy that saves lives. Highly religious people say they're happier too. So in addition to things like gross domestic product, which measure economic prosperity, there's also concepts like gross domestic happiness to measure how successful a society is. We want people to be happy, all other things being equal. And it turns out that highly religious people are also happier. They enjoy a higher quality of life, and that's good. And so happier and healthier, a number of evidence shows record less stress, less divorce, cope better with losing jobs and experiencing divorce, happier overall. So again, people around the world are prescribed medications like antidepressants. Very high rates of people are taking antidepressants because they're depressed or they're struggling with a divorce or a job loss. And so, you know, just like we would say those medications might have therapeutic benefit, we could say religion has therapeutic benefit and might actually prevent people having to take medications that might have side effects. And going back to gross domestic product, right, one measure of a country's success is its economy, and it turns out that religion is a massive boon to economies. So economies with highly religious countries have billions, you know, in the case of Canadian, my country, religion contributes $67.5 billion, and it makes wealthier, prosperous communities. It's good for your health. It adds to your life expectancy by somewhere between 4 and 7 years, even controlling for other factors. So now we know people are happier, they're healthier, they're living longer, their communities are more economically prosperous, it helps children's mental health, and etc. So in every possible way then that we can basically measure, religion is socially beneficial. It produces desirable changes in social demographics. And so from a policy point of view, would you want to remove or decrease religion? Well, no, because it's providing all these benefits and you're not going to want to remove or decrease something that's providing benefits. Would you want to support and increase it? Well, yes, all other things being equal, assuming there isn't some extra negative aspect to a certain form of religion that's unacceptable, if it's a, so to speak, a good form of religion that doesn't involve any kind of, you know, coercion or abuse that we don't want, then it should be supported. So whether that just means, you know, legally protected, or whether it's given tax,
1 minute,
tax breaks or whatever, or just even government, you know, encouraging religion through various programs or making religion available, that would be a good thing to do, because there's very few interventions we can make that hit so many desirable targets all at once, right? We could try and provide this, or we could try and provide that with policy, but religion seems to be something of a magic bullet, right? It helps in essentially every aspect, from the individual to the family to the community. So on that point, I'll yield my first turn the rest of the time.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. That's going to conclude round one. Thank you both. Hermes, we will start off round two here shortly. Can you confirm that you're ready?
Yes, I'm here.
Already, and round two will start now.
All right. So I'm going to go over the religion and health thing a little bit. There is strong evidence that there is a positive correlation there, but it's more complicated than just that. So I'm just going to read a little bit, and then I'm going to move on to the conflict perspectives and the issues of religion. I just still think I need to deal with the health part. So let's see, where do I go? So here, recently scholars have applied more, I'm reading from someone else, the Pew Forum, Pew Research. Recently, scholars have applied more scientific rigor to their research on religion, and many of the studies that have been published in the past 30 years have found that religious people tend to live longer, get sick less often, and are better to cope with stress. One study of adults in Texas, for example, found that regular service attendance is positively associated with a variety of healthy behaviors such as doctor visits, taking vitamins, and refraining from unhealthy behaviors such as alcohol and tobacco use. Another paper concluded that people whose obituaries reference religion tended to have lived longer than those whose obituaries made no mention of religion. In the Comprehensive Handbook of Religion and Health, Duke University professor Harold G. Koenig and co-authors summarized 21st century findings from the rapidly expanding field of religion and health research. According to their analysis, religion is positively associated with life satisfaction, happiness, and morale in 175 of 224 studies, which is a 78% positive confirmation. So furthermore, religion is positively associated with self-rated health in 27 of 48 studies. So that's 56, not too good. With lower rates of coronary heart disease in 12 out of 19 studies, 63%, and with fewer signs of psychoticism in 16 of 19, 84%. So of course, this also means that a substantial number of studies have found no clear association or even found that religion is associated with worse health health outcomes. For example, several studies have found that religious people tend to have a higher body mass index. Northwestern University cardiologist Matthew Feinstein and his colleagues, in an analysis of unusually large samples of 5,500 Americans, concluded that both religious service attendance and regular spiritual experiences are associated with higher rates of obesity. Other studies suggest that people who view humans as sinful and participate in religious communities that emphasize human sinfulness are more likely to suffer from anxiety and depression. All of these have links, by the way. And just as some religions seem to contribute positive health outcomes because they discourage alcohol and tobacco consumptions, other religions may lead to poor physical health outcomes due to certain behavioral prescriptions. For example, Jehovah's Witnesses oppose blood transfusions, and some religious groups, including certain Amish and Orthodox Jewish communities, discourage immunizations, as Koenig and his colleagues pointed out. Regardless of the specific outcomes reported by the major studies on this topic, it is worth noting that many attempts to link health and religion result in null findings, and that the research often has serious methodological limitations. Since most of these studies have been conducted in the U.S., Canada, and Western Europe, it is difficult to reach sweeping conclusions about the impact on religion on health on a truly global level. In addition, most of the research available relies on small samples, and research with larger number of respondents often use samples that are not representative of the broader population. This includes studies of only older adults, only women or men, clergy, members of specific denominations, or people in specific regions of a nation. There also has been a disproportionate focus on mental health. Far fewer research projects have looked at the relationship between religion and physical health. Perhaps most importantly, most of this research, including the cross-national study, has used. Basically, you know, the evidence seems to be there, but there is a lot of limitations to it. And also, I mean, if you go over the study, there's a huge difference between actively religious people and inactive. So the inactive and religiously unaffiliated are actually quite similar in performance in many of the cases. So I think that's also really important to point out. But since I have a minute left, I'll just kind of prime where I'm going to be going next. So I will be talking about, you know, religion on a big picture perspective now. I will be doing that, talking about, you know, conflicts, wars, how it can be used by the elite or the power class to subjugate the other people in society, how it can be used to justify cruelty and tyranny, torture.
And time.
Yeah.
All right, great, thank you. And Shogun, are you ready for round two?
Yes, sir.
All righty, your time will start now.
So just to address a few of Hermes's points, one that he mentioned was, you know, people who are not actively practicing religion don't experience the same benefits as those who are actively practicing religion. But that just proves the point further, right, that practicing religion actively provides the health benefit. So it's not surprising that if you're not, you know, doing it, it's like saying exercise is beneficial, but if you don't exercise, you don't get the benefit. Well, that's just further proof of how beneficial exercise, or in this case, religion, is. You also mentioned, you know, that there can be other factors in religion, like denying blood transfusions for Jehovah's Witnesses, et cetera, that might have negative health outcomes. And that's potentially true, but again, the point of this study, or these studies, because there's actually quite a few of them now, is that they've actually controlled for other factors to, you know, a fairly significant extent. And so the clear picture emerges that, you know, all other things being equal, controlling for other factors, there does clearly seem to be a benefit particular to religion itself, you know, above and beyond. Like, we know that there's benefits to having a healthy social group. So you might say, well, going to church is only healthy not because of religion, but just because it gives you a social group. And what we're finding is, well, no, there is some benefit to it that's because it's a social group, and that's a legitimate benefit. But there's also something above and beyond that that seems to be particular to religion. And I think you mentioned something about, you know, spirituality provides similar benefits, but actually there's an interesting study basically that showed that, you know, not only do religious people have much better mental health outcomes than non-religious people or atheists who have worse mental health outcomes. But strangely enough, people who identified as spiritual but not religious had even worse mental health outcomes than either atheists or religious people. So in practice, it doesn't bear out that you can get the same benefits from quote-unquote being spiritual but not religious. They actually seem to suffer even more than non-believers do in terms of, you know, rates of mental illness and so forth. So that's worth considering. Just like you acknowledge the many reasons why religion appears to be beneficial, I want to acknowledge that obviously there's many cases where religion can be harmful. You know, obvious examples being, you know, when genital mutilation or circumcision is practiced for religious reasons, you know, that causes harm to the baby. And that's a negative that's associated with religion, or religiously motivated, you know, terrorism that we're aware of that happens around the world has some religious motivation at times, often. And, you know, there's been all kinds of things like Sharia law, killing people for being homosexual, or stoning people for leaving their religion and apostasy and so forth. And so obviously in each of those cases, I'm not here to argue that any of that is good. All of that is terrible and bad. And anytime that kind of practice goes along with a religion, then not only do we not want to encourage it, it should be completely prohibited and against the law, because the law has to supersede, you know, religious freedom is secondary to like your right to life and autonomy of your body and stuff. But my thesis is, when you remove religions that involve crimes and violence against innocent people, and you just say, take those out of the pool, the remaining religion that doesn't do those kind of things is overwhelmingly beneficial. So in other words, just like with other things, the solution to bad religion is not no religion. The solution to bad religion is good religion, right? And so what we want to do is cultivate and encourage the best aspects of religion, and obviously not any of the negatives. And of course, you know, in Christianity, for example, we're taught not to circumcise anyways, so that doesn't apply, for example. There's no Sharia law, et cetera, et cetera. So we've gone over all the numerous benefits.
1 minute.
As proven by statistics. So in my next turn, I think I'm going to go in more detail theoretically about why it is that religion is so beneficial and why it's therefore so important. And I think there's a number of aspects to that, some of which Hermes has already acknowledged. Everything from social cohesion to providing meaning and the ability to contextualize our experiences in a way that allows us to endure trauma and grief and stress more effectively, which then allows us to be more happy, healthy, and productive and be there for our families. And it binds communities and families together and provides incentives for stability in marriage and child rearing. So really, you know, it's a wonderful sort of social panacea, as long as you control its worst excesses and make sure those forms don't manifest. And I'll yield time.
All right, thank you. Very interesting from both sides. This will conclude round two. We're going to move on to round three. Are you ready, Hermes?
Yes.
Great. And your time will start now.
Okay. Now I'm just going to introduce the conflict perspective on religion. Again, I'm taking this from the Sociology in Our Times. Can you just stop for like a few seconds? I need to do something real quick. Just stop 1 minute. This is noise coming.
Yeah, I'll pause your time.
Thank you. 1 sec.
Quick intermission, because real life does happen.
I'm sorry. Okay, I think it's better now.
Yeah, okay. So, as long as you're ready, I can restart.
I'm ready. I'm ready.
Alrighty, here we go.
All right, so from a conflict perspective, religion tends to promote conflict between groups and societies. According to conflict theorists, conflict between religious groups, for example, anti-Semitism within a religious group, for example, when a splinter group leaves an existing domination, or between religious groups and a larger society, for example, the conflict over religion in the classroom. Conflict theorists assert that in attempting to provide meaning and purpose in life, while at the same time promoting the status quo, religion is used by the dominant class to impose their own social control over society and its resources. systematic view of the way systematic views of the way the world ought to be are embodied in religious doctrines and political values. These ideologies serve to justify the status quo and restrict social change. The capitalist class uses a religious ideology as a tool of domination to mislead the workers about their true interests. Marx wrote in his now famous statement that religion is the opiate of the masses. People become complacent because they've been taught to believe in an afterlife in which they will be rewarded for their suffering and misery in this life. Although these religious teachings soothe the masses' distress and any relief, is illusory. According to Marx, religion unites people in a false consciousness that they share common interests with members of the dominant class. Also, the wealthy can use religion to justify their power and privilege. It is a sign of God's approval of their hard work and morality. As for the poor, if they work hard and live a moral life, they will be richly rewarded in another life. So the wealthy get rewarded in this life. The poor, well, they got to wait to the next life. According to also feminist theories, religious symbolism and language consistently privilege men over women. Religious symbolism depicts the higher deities as male and the lower deities as females. Women are more likely than men to be depicted as negative or evil spiritual forces in religion. So this is just a little bit from the conflict perspective. And then I'm going to just jump into it myself. So the idea that religion is good for society might have been an idea that it would entertain if there was a global religion. But the very fact that there isn't, and that we can see the conflict that arises from religion, global conflict, wars where millions of people have been killed, I'm talking about the Hindus or whatever. When we look at it on the big picture scale, religion is actually probably the most bloody thing ever. It's kind of like a slow fire in that it seems nice and warm and pleasant when you look at it from up, like, you know, when you're not looking at the big picture. When you scale back and see that it's actually the entire planet that's, you know, on fire, then you realize that, it's not as pretty as I thought it was. Even right now, today, many of the problems of today's world, from terrorism to international conflict to terrorists, I mean, I already said that, but I can even go back. We can go back to the Inquisition and torture and a lot of horrible things that was done in the name of religion. We can go look at theocratic societies like Iran and many other countries like Saudi Arabia, which impose draconian laws that basically restrict the population and causes actual harm to those people. Obviously, those things are not taken into the studies for health, but if we were to actually take into factor the victims of religion, then it would be actually far more terrible than the flowery image of it being really useful for our health. After all, you know, ignorance is bliss, but bliss doesn't necessarily mean good. There was a really awesome quote, which was, ignorance is bliss, but you cannot ignore the consequences of ignorance. So you can be happy, but the consequences are going to come hit you sooner or later. And this is one of those things where I would say the consequences is not felt more by the individual, but by society in large, specifically the future generations. I'm done.
Great. Thank you, Hermes. And Shogun, you're ready for round 3?
Yes.
Alrighty, your time will start now.
Okay. So just to respond to a few points, so like we mentioned, there are certainly many examples of negatives associated with religion. An obvious one is religiously motivated terrorism, suicide bombings, etc. People believe they can go to paradise in cases by committing these acts because of certain Islamic interpretations of Islamic teachings. And if you look at this is like overwhelmingly 99% Islam that's associated with these kind of terrorist attacks, and almost non-existent in most other traditions. So I'd argue that's a case of sort of the exception that proves the rule. Religion is powerful. That's what we kind of realize. Religion is enormously powerful. And like we know, power can be turned toward positive or negative ends. And so again, I just say the solution to bad expressions of religion is not to get rid of religion, which I don't think is really, well, yeah, it's not desirable, even if it is possible. Rather, we want to harness the power of religion, because you think about it, if religion is powerful enough that people are willing to commit suicide, like blow themselves up, give everything for this, then obviously it's very powerful. But we want people to express that faith and that motivation towards positive ends. And that does indeed happen, right? So Christianity is the largest contributor to charity in history, right? So the majority of charitable works, donations, giving food to the poor, and all the other forms of charity, medicine and healthcare that's been provided, has been by the Christian church historically. So that's an example of just an overwhelming material and realistic consequence of certain positive Christian teachings. Like, for example, Jesus said, as you do unto the least of these, meaning the poor, the homeless, the downtrodden, so you do unto me. And as a basically a direct manifestation of that positive Christian doctrine, you have the incredible, you know, for hundreds of thousands of years all over the world, Christians providing various kinds of charitable help to people in need to try and do what, you know, Jesus wants them to do and what's right in their understanding religiously. And I would argue that the basis of our moral principles today are Christian in nature. We talk about Judeo-Christian civilization, but, you know, our very concept of, you know, be kind to one another largely derives from Jesus's teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's the golden rule. That's still what we try and instill in children today. And I think it's very true that the old system was, you know, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth kind of thing. And so the teachings of Christianity permanently on a global level kind of advanced human ethics in ways that have all these different implications. Religion provides, you know, meaning and also provides ways in which people can improve their character and motivations for them to do so. When you talk about the bloodiness of religion, of course, there's certainly cases where that's true. But actually, if you look at a breakdown, historically and statistically, the conception people have that most wars were religious in nature, totally untrue. It's actually quite a small minority of wars that were primarily religious in nature. Now, most of them have other reasons, like, you know, geopolitical, resource, ideological, you know, whatever, population collision or whatever the case may be. But purely religious conflicts and wars are fairly uncommon. You know, the Crusades was an example of a religiously motivated war, but that one kind of stands out as somewhat unusual. Also, it's worth pointing out that, you know, the most bloody regimes in history, you know, that killed the most innocent people and so forth were often atheists, specifically atheists, and many attempts at, like, state atheism.
1 minute.
Also resulted in, whether directly or indirectly, were associated with huge crimes against humanity. So it's not like we can say that atheism is a solution to violence or mass murder, because, you know, again, horrible crimes against humanity have happened under atheist regimes as well. And again, things like the Inquisition and the child abuse scandal in the Catholic Church, again, that those are real, and that's a real problem. But you can also say that, you know, it's kind of the exception that proves the rule, or rather, again, example of bad abuses of what might still be a good thing. But I'd agree we need to do a lot to make sure those abuses don't take place and make sure that's not part of the kinds of religion that we support. And I'll yield my time.
Amazing. Alrighty, this will conclude round three. And we're going to head into round four. Hermes, are you ready?
Yes.
All righty. And take it away.
All right. So I'm going to go back to and dispute one of the things you said. Values comes from Christian values, or like Christianity is like the basis of our values or whatever. I absolutely disagree. I would say that Christianity actually was one of the factors that plunged us to the Dark Ages. It was the Enlightenment that was actually what got us out of that hellhole. And the principles of the Enlightenment are almost diametrically opposed to the principles of Judeo-Christian values. And I'll just go over real quickly over what it was and the ideas and what came from the Enlightenment and its roots, the Renaissance and humanism and many other things. So I'll just read this quick summary from Wikipedia to give a little bit of introduction. The Age of Enlightenment, also known as the Age of Reason or simply the Enlightenment, was an intellectual and philosophical movement that dominated the world of ideas in Europe in the 17th and 18th centuries. The Enlightenment included a range of ideas centered in the value of human happiness, the pursuit of knowledge obtained by the means of reason and the evidence of the senses, and ideals such as liberty, progress, toleration, fraternity, constitutional government, and a separation of church and state. The Enlightenment has its roots in European intellectual and scholarly movement known as the Renaissance humanism, and was also preceded by the Scientific Revolution and the work of Francis Bacon, among others. And I can go more and more into it, but I would say that right now the benefits of Western society and the luxury and the power and the domination that we enjoy is not due to religious ideals or religious values, but due to the values from the Enlightenment. And I would also say that the First Amendment, like, basically directly opposes the First Commandment. One is freedom of religion, the other one is only worship me, which is diametrically opposed. The separation of church and state, I would say, is one of the greatest things that ever happened for Western, most of Western civilization. And I'm really glad that it did. I'm going to talk about the charity part. So yeah, sure, a lot of charity goes through religion, but that doesn't mean that it's necessarily a good thing. So first of all, religious institutions have tax exemptions, and you get tax breaks if you donate. So there are other incentives other than just humanitarian goodwill. Also, where does all the money go? How do you sustain this institution if all the money was going to charity? It's more like it's funneling some of its, income to charity, and at the same time, gaining tax breaks and many other benefits. And at the same time, you get publicity and, a lot of other, positives. So it's not like it's being done without anything in return. There are other motivations behind it as well. Another thing, bad religion and good religion. I do agree that when something is bad, you got to replace it with something better rather than abandon it. But I wouldn't say religion has to be necessarily the case. We're talking about values here, or system. Or institutions. I would say the institution of religion in and of itself is messed up. One of the worst reasons for that, one of the best reasons for that is it's impractical to have the entire world being one religion. That's never going to happen. Just not going to, it's virtually impossible. I don't know, maybe in the future it's going to be some crazy stuff that I can't even imagine. But as the world stands today, it is much more conflictual, much more divided, even within the same religion through dominations. People continuously have differing clashes based on their beliefs, which is not grounded in reality, but in some sort of supernatural thing that you can't test, which leads to people living living lives based on some irrationality rather than something grounded in reality, which to me is far more dangerous than anything else. Also, I want to go back to one of the other things I said, suicide rates. This is way back. If you tell someone they're going to be tortured eternally or whatever, if they kill themselves, sure, they might not kill themselves, but I wouldn't say that's the best way of, convincing someone to not kill themselves. And I do know that a lot of people have not killed themselves because they thought they were going to burn and die, burn for eternity. So it's like a worse outcome if you kill yourself. There's a lot more, actually. I wish there were more rounds, but I'm done for now, I guess.
All right, great. And Shogun, you can proceed to round 4 when you're ready. Can you just confirm you're there?
Yes, sir.
Great. Okay, and you can begin now.
Okay. So just a reminder, what we're debating today is religion a positive or a negative force? Arguments that it's positive, the demographics, right? All the positive outcomes in every different level of individual life, from, economic to mental health to physical health to life expectancy, to GDP, and as all is reasons why we might say that religion is positive for society. So I would argue the statistics and the science is overwhelmingly in favor of this argument. But I'd like to also point out how our morality truly is largely and positively influenced by religious ideology, in particular Christianity. So just consider how we would raise a child today, trying to socialize them to be good people and grow up to be good people that we would like and respect, and, you know, other people would respect and would treat other people well. Well, what was Jesus's actual teaching, right? Was it some horrible thing? Well, he taught, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. He taught, love your God and love your neighbor as yourself. He taught, you know, obviously forgiveness. He taught to help the poor, do unto others as you would have, as you do unto the least of these, so you do unto me. So these directly lead to, like we said, the largest charitable organization in the world. They directly lead to, you know, both motivation and incentive and instruction on how to treat other people well. And that provides the basis of our concept of morality that persists today, right? You know, treating other people the way we would want them to be treated. That's the golden rule. These teachings are concise and they have, you know, enormously positive ramifications when applied in people's lives. And then you can see that in many ways, right? So if you look at some of these studies, psychological studies, they've shown that religious people are more altruistic than atheists. They're more likely to be giving and to be altruistic and positive, benevolent towards other people. And that directly ties into the higher levels of charitable giving, right? They're more likely to have sources of emotional support and community and psychological support. And that leads to the lower depression, lower drug use, lower suicide rate. And that helps society, it helps families. And then that has intergenerational effects, because if your religious beliefs help you to be stable and live longer and be healthier and not drink too much, then you raise your children in a more stable environment, and then they also experience better mental health outcomes. So these are all positive things. And when you look at, you know, Karl Marx famously said, religion is the opiate of the masses, and people at times take that to mean it's a bad thing. And of course, opiates do have negative sides to them, but at the same time, opiates are an essential medicine, right? We need painkillers, we need anesthetics. And I'm not saying that's all religion is, but it is one thing it does, is it provides people solace and comfort in times of grief, like the loss of a child, where there's really no other way to cope at times, and yet this can provide people great peace and comfort in those times, and that is beneficial. So I'm trying to think if there was other points I meant to respond to. So let's just talk a little bit more about why religion is so vital. Well, another point I wanted to make is that religion is universal, right? Every culture around the world, from primordial prehistoric times to modern times, has always had religion as part of its social organization. So like the sociological point of view of structural functionalism would indicate that these existing structures in society have functions, and we've already postulated what many of those are: social continuity, you know, community building, you know, stabilization of relationships, and you know, solidification of social norms. Mutually agreed upon social norms around marriage and providing coming of age rituals, right? Manhood and womanhood, cemeteries, I mean, funerals, marriages, all of these things are parts of the meaning of our life. And things like ritual and tradition and customs like this provide meaning. And what humans are defined, in my opinion, by one trait, which is that we're a narrative species. So as far as we know, we're unique among animals in that we use a structure called language to contextualize our own lives and experience, and the extent to which we can do so successfully has essentially more influence on our happiness and success than any other factor. So people can endure almost any hardship as long as they have a what for them is a coherent and sincere worldview that makes sense of what they're experiencing and puts it in a broader, meaningful context. That's what religion provides. That's what people need. And otherwise, things like nihilism.
Time. Okay, thank you to both of our participants. We're going to now head into the fifth and final round. Hermes is going to kick this one off. Are you ready?
Yes.
and go.
All right, so I think it's really important to point out that morality existed before religion. There are biological and sociological factors behind morality. For example, cooperation is more conducive towards, you know, successfully passing on your genes to the next generation than stabbing and killing anyone, you know, for whatever reason. So there is logical and functional reasons behind morality besides God, or because some deity said something. I just really want to point that out. Also, another thing, the altruistic thing, as I said, you know, tax exempt is one of the reasons. Another one could be like you could be buying your way into heaven. And another one could be you're covering up for your guilt. You know, I mean, a lot of people confess or do weird stuff to make up for whatever else they did. But this is kind of fucked up because, like, if you pay the church because you did something bad, you're not actually solving the problem. You know, you're not addressing that problem. You're just giving to the church and convincing yourself God is gonna. So there's a lot of weird reasons why people donate. Also, it's a habit. You know, it's not like it's like 10% or whatever. I think that's kind of like a rule. Again, you kind of got to do it if you're part of the community. So it's kind of like sheep. They just do it. So here's the here's a list of reasons that I think religion is horrible. So one, it fosters complacency. It fosters submission to authority. It definitely fosters anti-curiosity, anti-questioning, and anti-testing. Do not test the Lord, blah, blah, blah. It is rigid. It's stagnant. It is backwards. By definition, it is rigid because it's not changing. It's stagnant because it's not changing. It's backwards because it's thousands of years old and it's limited by the knowledge we had at that time. Divisions between, here's the biggest one, divisions between groups and subgroups. Once again, religion can sound really fancy and nice if we ignore the fact that there are different denominations and there are different religions, and they don't really take kindly to each other. And none of them agree on what the world is. And I think that is very dangerous when people in the world cannot agree on reality. And if the majority of people that are religious have completely different worldviews about what reality is, what is our purpose in this world, I think that conflict and that incongruity to be very, very harmful. I would say that religion also, in general, kind of has an aversion to rationality and reason in general, because when you try to... can you please pause the timer for 1 minute again?
Yes, pause it now.
Thank you.
And thank you all for attending, or if you're listening on another platform, we're here on the Knights of the Round Table Discord. So you can check into us. You can look into the links below, and we'll give you some scoops to come after the debate concludes. We're currently in round 5. Our participants are Shogun and H3RM3S. And we're going to kick back off with H3RM3S's take on round 5 as soon as he's back.
I'm back. Sorry about that. I just, niece called. I feel really bad not being able to talk, but the timing is just horrible. Anyways, where was I? Aversion to rationality. So one of the reasons is that it fosters an aversion to rationality due to having an affinity for dogmatic justification or unverifiable claims that require a leap of faith. So whenever you want to try to justify religion, in most cases, you end up with circular logic or leap of faith or something that you can't really verify, which kind of makes reasoning seem irrational and useless. And it becomes more like, just take a leap of faith. The Lord knows better than I, so why should I know, kind of thing. There is also the issue of circumcision, and I think the U.S. has, like, I think 70% or a huge percent of the population is circumcised, so that's genital mutilation for both men and women happen, you know, other places too, but men mostly, for some reason, it's just normalized. As I originally pointed out, terrorism is one of the worst problems we face as a society, and that is directly related to religion. And of course, you can say good or bad, but you can say that for everything, you know. I'm looking at the entire thing of religion, the totality of it. Religion has a very bloody history, from the Inquisitions to the Islamic conquests that killed hundreds of millions of Hindus and whatever.
It's
horrible. I would say that religion is largely incompatible with reality and modern science. Evolution is, you know, just one of the things that kind of goes against it, which is why a lot of people try to fight against teaching that in school. Also, another problem with religion is that religion forces people to be good through the fear of punishment or reward from God, and not through some sort of moral understanding. It's like when a parent tells a kid not to do a thing because they say so, rather than explaining why it is bad to do a thing. So in this case, I would say, yeah, it's better for the parent to say don't do it, but it's better if you explain why. And religion doesn't really do that. So I would say also more people have died from religion than any atheistic wars if we take in the entire history of religion, including the millions, hundreds of millions of Hindus that were killed. And you can even see like the walls created from space in India. It's like you can observe it.
Time. Fascinating, truly. And Shogun, this will be your final take, round five, when you're ready.
Thank you.
All right, and you can begin.
So for the final round, I'll do a little bit of review and a few final arguments. The argument, again, is religion a positive or a negative force? I would conclude that, with a caveat, that there do exist negative forms of religion. I think we can point to, you know, specific ones that have specific qualities. So I can't defend religion as a whole, because there are religions that have negative social outcomes. You know, I believe Islam has unique problems. So we have to put an asterisk in here and maybe say not so much Islam, right? But if I'm permitted to make that asterisk and say I'm essentially speaking about Christianity, Buddhism, Hinduism, etc., but not Islam, and not predatory cults, etc., like Scientology, then I can make the following argument: that it provides enormous social benefits and individual benefits at the family level, the community level, and the human level, the species level. And again, these are the kind of indicators we would use to assess a question like, is this a positive or negative force for society? So it's positive in all these ways. And so if I was an administrator, if I was a hypothetical administrator of a country making policy, and they said, well, sir, should we make policies to encourage religion or discourage religion? I would probably say we should make moderate policies to encourage positive forms of religion. That could look like different things, but it would just mean you would not discourage, and you would in some way support, you know, positive expressions of religion, like churches that operate soup kitchens and feed the homeless, or you know, places that provide religious, you know, alcohol and addictions counseling, like AA. These are examples of like positive expressions of religion that we would want to support, because they are indeed benevolent and they do provide useful and good services. We can quantify that in all these different ways. When you say, you know, oh, religion's so bloody, look at all the bloody stuff. Again, yes, a lot of that Islam, like you said, the Mughal occupation of India was incredibly savage, you know, and that's a uniquely problematic form of ideology at times. But I would say the history of the human race is extremely bloody. And at the same time, religion is universal. So therefore, anytime there's conflict, religion is going to coexist with that conflict, right? Christians don't stop being Christians in times of war, and Muslims don't stop being Muslim in times of war. So if there's going to be war, there's always going to be a religious aspect to it. People are always going to pray to their God for victory and think that they're on the right side. But that correlation doesn't necessarily equal causation. And when it's actually been studied academically, as I said, only a small minority of conflicts are thought to have been truly religious in nature. In other words, these fights were going to happen anyway for other reasons. And they just happen to be between different religious groups, rather than, oh, my religion says I have to go kill you, I'm going to go kill you. That's not usually the case. Again, with some exceptions, like the belief of jihad or whatever the case may be in certain applications of it. But So the point is, it's not really clear that religion led to all this violence in most cases. And again, there are exceptions like the fights over the Holy Land and so forth between different religions. But the point is, and it also hasn't been shown that atheistic religions are less violent, right? So we don't want violence, but it's not clear that getting rid of religion is going to get rid of violence, and attempts to get rid of religion have often led to horrible violence in and of themselves. So if I think about it on a personal level, would I want to raise my children religious? That's a pretty good way to know, is this positive or not? Would I want my own kids to? And for me, the answer is an unequivocal yes, because again, I can see these studies telling me children raised religiously have better mental health. They're less likely to become...
1 minute.
They're less likely to experience, you know, unwanted teen pregnancies or drugs and alcohol. They're going to be happier and healthier. So it's benevolent and logical for me to raise them as religious, because it's positive and benevolent and good for them. And there's no coercion. You're just teaching them these things. And again, what is religion in its positive form is Christianity. It's a benevolent moral system. It's a way to understand the world and our responsibilities from an ethical point of view. It provides incentives to do good to one another and to care about our own conduct, and provides us peace and solace at times that's very necessary. And in the Bible, it talks about the fruits of the Holy Spirit being love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The concept of loving your neighbor as yourself is a very efficient and concise moral teaching.
And time. All right. Thank you both to Shogun and Hermes. This is Destrictiony, and I'm going to hand the mic over to Shogun. Tuning out. Great debate. And take it away.
Thank you, Hermes. That was great. If someone can do me a favor and create the three straw polls, in the podcast text channel, I guess, or in general chat, whichever, I guess in podcast text, so that only those of us here will vote on it. Again, the three questions that we would like made are, which side of the debate did you agree with, right? Which position did you agree with, regardless of who did better? Which position do you share? Second, who do you think did better, whether you agreed with them or not? Who debated better? Who made the better points? And then third, did listening to the debate change your opinion on the issue? So if anybody can make one of those polls, I'd really appreciate it. I don't know how. But it's now open for audience questions or comments. If anyone wants to ask anything or say anything, and we'll discuss freely for a while, and then we'll see what the results of those polls are after there's been some time for people to vote.
I got a question for Hermes, if that's okay.
Yeah, sure.
So I assume you wouldn't want to raise one of your children with religious values. How would you ensure that they have a community, or do you even think it's important for them to have a community? And then what philosophy or ideology would you build that community around if you had children and were raising them?
I mean, would I raise them religious? No. That would be the answer. First of all, I'm not going to have kids, but in the hypothetical, no. Would I want them to have a community? Absolutely. Humans are social creatures. We're quite interdependent. Without society, we can barely survive at all. Everything we have is due to social interaction, working with others, basically from the clothes, the tools, the computers, everything. And as such, I think it is incredibly important for people to create social connections. I would want the hypothetical kid to have as many friends as possible. There'd be hobby groups, you know, bowling, whatever, this, that, sports, anything, school, academics, clubs, philosophy clubs, you know, stuff like that is basically what I would do if I was a parent. And as a replacement for value, I would just teach philosophy as it is. I almost do it from the ground up. So I would be like, you know, what is philosophy? Well, philosophy means, you know, love of wisdom, and what is contained within philosophy. I would talk about the tools that's used in every branch of philosophy, which is logic. So I would start with logic to the best of my ability. I would actually teach logic and language simultaneously to my kid. Because they're interrelated, like locked, and like you can convert one to another. So if you learn it at the same time, I think it would be even better. In fact, a lot of the times when I write papers or write arguments or anything, I am doing it from that other perspective. I'm like, X equals Y, X equals this, this equals that, religion is this, this is that, this is, you know, it's like I'm making these short statements, atomic statements. And to me, I used to be kind of shitty at grammar initially. But that's because it was just horrible, I would guess. I don't know, I'm making excuses. But regardless, after going through logic, language, and everything else made a million times more sense to me. Is there anything else to the question?
Yeah, I mean, all right. That, I guess it's a lone good than like maybe 10 or 9. What would you do for heuristics for values and morals when they are, you know, 4 or 6 or 5, you know? Like, what is your particular, like, stories? I want to know where the values are coming from, where the justifications are, because clearly you can't teach like social contract theory to a 4-year-old. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. So. Yeah. I'm totally inexperienced in this. I would have to probably look at some literature with respect to psychology. I know the human brain, there's like different stages of development. There's the object performance, this, that. I forgot there are many different stages that you go through. And, I would say what you teach, it has to be relative or taking into consideration the stage of development you're in. So yeah, for sure, I would not teach some crazy advanced stuff initially. However, I would say that the basics of logic really is as simple as the basics of math, even simpler. And we do learn most like basic math, like in first grade. So I would start really early when it comes to like the most basics of logic, the if and or, if then, if and only if, you know, that kind of shit. That I would have to read, really. I don't know. This is a question that would require a lot of research to be able to accurately give you a good answer.
I mean, but is there anyone who's able to make the traditional question polls for us? I don't know how to
do it. I can do it. I'll do it as we're talking.
Thank you. So if you do it in the RT podcast, the podcast text channel, it's just above us, guys. If you look, we're on the audio podcast voice chat. And if you go up 2 channels, there's podcast text. So that's where the 3 polls are going to be. So again, just once you make them, please take some time to vote if you heard the debate. Who do you agree with? Which position do you agree with? Who do you think did better? And did listening to the debate change your point of view? Thank you for making those, Hermes. Does anyone else have any questions or comments?
I want to actually say something myself that I've been holding. Can we do round 2, part 2 to this? Because I was... I felt like I went through a quarter of what I wanted to go through. So part 2 would be great.
Yeah, of course. And I would argue technically it's like part 3 kind of, because we also did a debate way back in the day on whether Christianity was a good or bad thing for society, remember? So I'm going to find that episode now and post that in general chat in case anyone wants to listen to that one. But yeah, I love doing debates, so we could definitely do another round. It's posted there now in general chat, our debate about Christianity. So, so I think what I'd like to point out, and not trying to, you know, whatever, continue the debate exactly, but just, you know, we know that religion is something that provides an incredible amount of social energy, social force, and we know that that social force can be channeled towards, you know, almost any end that you can imagine. From, you know, building pyramids to radical pacifism all the way to successful, you know, warrior traditions. So, you know, my question would just be, why wouldn't we want to channel that power in productive and useful ways? If we know it has all this potential, why wouldn't we want to harness that potential in a positive way rather than, you know, try and removing its negatives by removing its existence? You know, isn't that a form of... throwing the baby out with the bathwater, you know, and wouldn't reform of religion be a more rational response than abolishment of it?
Yeah, I'll answer that. So I would say that it is, I wouldn't be throwing it away, in that I'm not saying there shouldn't be anything that replaces it. I'm saying that it shouldn't be religion. So for example, we can look at the functionalities of religion, from health to social cohesion, meaning, purpose, all of those things. And then we can look at alternatives that can provide those things. For example, as we were moving towards secularism, a lot of the religious practices, institutions, and a lot of the stuff that used to happen on a large scale in society and the significance of it went down significantly. And what was replaced was social institutions in their place, in most cases, government, whatever, separation from state and church, just a lot of other stuff, you know, the rule of law, the court, constitution, you know, all these things, which I think is great. So I would say look at the functionality and then find one that's more grounded in reality. And I would say philosophy, one that's grounded in reality, one that we can all agree on. And that's, to me, the most important thing, is that one of the worst consequences of living in a world of religion is that almost anybody has their own worldview that's completely incompatible with another person's worldview, or at least if they're in another denomination or another group or whatever, another religion, they're incompatible. Yet we're living in the same reality. And I think that's one of the most horrifying and terrifying things. When people don't have common ground, communication becomes difficult, interaction becomes difficult, cooperation becomes difficult, especially long-term. And I'll also say the ideas that, you know, Christ is coming back or whatever can have harmful repercussions with respect to global warming or whatever. Basically, oh, well, fuck the world, you know. Christ is coming back in 50 or 40 years or in your lifetime. Why would you care? And I went over a poll for that, but it was a disturbingly large amount of people that think Christ is going to return in their lifetime, which, you know, with beliefs like that, it's possible for a person not to care so much about the future of this world with respect to environmental concerns and whatever. I mean, I want to do part two and formalize it.
You make the second two poll questions, please, if you can.
Yeah. Sorry, I got distracted in my answer. So I answered that. That's the second one. And the third one, I'll make grid poll.
Yeah. So again, if you guys heard the debate, and only if you heard the debate, then please take a minute to vote. The three questions are in the podcast text channel. I thought that was a good debate. I enjoyed it. We've done many debates in the past on many topics, not just me and Hermes, but me and Drewish and other people. If anyone ever wants to do a debate, please, you know, suggest a topic or whatever. I'm always happy to debate almost anything. If we can find a good question, we'll do a part two on this. And, you know, me and Hermes have done ones on creationism versus you know, non-creationism, or about intelligent design, about atheism, about Christianity, and many variations on the subject. So you can find those in our podcast history. Yeah, but as regards to, you know, replacing religion with things like philosophy and so forth, you know, perhaps not. We don't really know that is quote unquote possible, in the sense that, you know, it's not like people don't have philosophy now. So when we're looking at, you know, the benefits of religion, that's not occurring as a replacement of philosophy, or it's not like philosophy doesn't exist. In other words, you don't have to choose. You could always still have your religious faith and philosophy or whatever thing other that you might want to replace it with. And if religion does have a benefit all its own, then you can't really replace it. You could get benefit from something else, but not necessarily the same benefit from religion. And then if you added religion to whatever else you chose, you'd presumably get even more benefit. So, yeah, there's that. And also you mentioned, you know, how important it is to have common ground and how bad it is when people don't share a worldview. And that's precisely why religion ends up being useful and powerful and universal. Precisely because it does provide cognitive and cosmological and, you know, epistemological and moral common ground. And it's not like without religion we would have that common ground. We'd have less of it, actually, all things being equal, because even if you're not religious, people have wildly different beliefs and worldviews about things like politics and ideologies and opinions and tastes. So, you know, it's not really religion that's causing that. And it's actually religion that can be one of the biggest solutions to it. It's a valid point that multiple religions exist. And then there's an inherent sort of issue around that, you know, people not agreeing with other religions. But to try and sort of remove religion because people don't agree on religion is sort of also probably an impossible idea anyway. It'd be like removing politics because people argue about politics. It'd be like saying, oh, well, politics is bad because Republicans don't get along with Democrats, you know, but you can't remove that dimension of life.
So should we finish this jump up or any more questions?
Yeah, are there any, sorry, we didn't mean to, are there any more questions or comments? Take a minute to vote if you haven't. Anything from anyone? All right, well, hopefully you guys voted. I'm just gonna take a second to read the results of whatever we have that did come in. Again, there's no winners or losers. It's just for the sake of interest. Oh, nobody voted. Okay, well, screw you guys then.
Well, no, it's showing up like that. It's showing 0-0 for all of us. We're saying that in the chat right now.
Doesn't that mean nobody voted, though?
I voted, and then I tried to look at the results.
All right, well, maybe they'll start working later. I don't know what's going on with that, because it just says 0 votes.
The voting bot is being non-cooperative.
Okay, well, we'll the results later. Sorry if you were listening to this on YouTube or BitChute and you know, this left you hanging on the results, but for some reason they're not coming through. Nevertheless, thank you all for listening. Thank you for participating and asking questions. Thanks Hermes and Rafi and Thorsten for recording. Thank you. Make sure you've joined the Roundtable Discord server. Special events every day, actually in an hour at 8 o'clock, we're going to have an open discussion about, you know, politics, geopolitics, and World War III concerns about Russia and China. So hang around for that in less than an hour. And tomorrow we'll be having another podcast with Drakkar. That's going to be about telepathy. Relationship is a key to a connected species, answer to everything, and coexistence with extraterrestrials. That'll be tomorrow at 4. Check out the Roundtable podcast on SoundCloud, YouTube, and BitChute. And join us on the server if you haven't already. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Hermes. God bless.